Right, so let me just adjust the lights here, plunge you all into darkness. You'll catch up on your sleep. There we go, right. Okay, so I apologize that some of you have seen this talk before. Only a couple. So this is about one of the questions that I introduced in the first lecture about higher symmetries of the Laplacian. Okay, and I'll just remind you of what the question is. But first, let me give you some references. So this is all based on the following articles. mainly on this first one, and some comments about this, and some variation on this at the end. Okay, so this is the it's all published some time ago. And some thanks to these people, especially Ed Witten. Okay, so he asked the following question. So here's the question. Okay, this is the question on Rn for n greater than or equal to 3. And the question is this. So which linear differential operators on R3 preserve harmonic functions? Okay, so you can ask this on Rn, but here's the answer on R3. Okay, so I gave this list on yesterday, but here is exactly the same list again, just to refresh your memories. Okay, so the first thing you can do is you can ask about zeroth order differential operators, in other words, multiplication by a function. So when does that preserve harmonic functions? If and only if the function that you're multiplying by is a constant. Okay, so here is a complete list of all the zeroth order differential operators. There's a one-dimensional space of such things. You can multiply your function by any constant, and it's still harmonic. Okay, what about first order operators? Well, because the Laplacian is invariant under translation, then the infinitesimal statement of that is that these functions, the coordinate derivatives, preserve harmonic functions. In fact, they commute with the Laplacian, and that's why they preserve harmonic functions. And similarly, so do these differential operators. you can just check this by hand, that this operator commutes with the Laplacian, but this is the infinitesimal generator of rotation. So this is the infinitesimal generator of rotation about the x3 axis. Okay, so that. So these. Okay, so these six operators we've got so far. So etc. here means that you can, instead of taking x1 and x2 as your variables, you can take x2 and x3 or x3 and x1. So you can cycle them around. There are three different possibilities there, and I've just written out one of them. So these actually, if you take these things, these six differential operators, or six-dimensional space of differential operators, that's a precise list of the first-order operators which commute with the Laplacian, including this one. There's an optional zeroth-order part. Okay, then there's this one. This is dilation. Doesn't quite commute with the Laplacian, but it still preserves harmonic functions. And then there's some slightly surprising things if you haven't seen them before. That's these differential operators. Again, there are three possibilities here. So when I write etc. here, I mean that I can, instead of putting x1 here, I can put x2 and x3 and make appropriate changes over there. This is just multiplication by this operator. Right? So it's got a non-trivial zeroth order part. And then there's these things. Everything else are vector fields. This one's got a first order part, a zeroth order part as well. Okay, so these are now a complete list, up to taking linear combinations, of all of the first order differential operators which preserve harmonic functions. Okay, there's an 11-dimensional family of such a thing, but if I ignore the zeroth order ones, then there's a 10-dimensional family of sort of interesting ones, the first order ones. Now, if you've got a couple of these things, you can take their commutator like this. And if the D1 and D2 are first-order operators, then their commutator will still be a first-order operator. And so that makes this, well, 11-dimensional space in the first instance into a Lie algebra. And you can ask, what Lie algebra is this? And, well, it has a commutator subalgebra. So if you just look at taking the Lie brackets of everything in this Lie algebra, you get down to 10 dimensions. And what happens is that, well, you get a closed 10-dimensional subalgebra. This happens by, you have to take a particular subset here, a particular 10-dimensional subspace. And what you have to do is you have to add in a half here. So in other words, you take this constant times f as a zeroth order operator and just tweak this one a little bit by putting in multiplication by a half as the zeroth order part. And then, so this is a perfectly natural thing, it's forced on you by looking at the commutator subalgebra, then these 10-dimensional space is a Lie algebra all by itself, and what you get is precisely this Lie algebra as an abstract Lie algebra. Right, so at this point, you're not starting with anything to do with conformal geometry or anything, but nevertheless, out of here you get a Lie algebra which you recognize as having something to do with conformal transformations in three dimensions. So it's just appeared out of thin air. So this is a motivating question for why you should even look at conformal geometry, because, you know, the Laplacian is the most fundamental differential operator one can think of. And, you know, somehow, just by looking at this simple question, you generate conformal transformations somehow. What you think might be conformal transformations, okay, at the moment. There's no connection right now, but that's what we're going to do. Okay, so this is, should just note at this stage that this is the conformal algebra. Right, so it arouses one's suspicions of something deeper going on. Right, now this was first order operators, so now we're going to look at second order operators. So the second order operators were classified by Boyer, Kalnins, and Miller in 1976. So there's an article in a Japanese journal, and then there's a book by Willard Miller with more details. But essentially, the point of this book is to look at these higher order symmetries, so second order symmetries of the Laplacian, and also they look at the case of the Laplacian plus a constant. So Helmholtz operator, as they call it. Okay, and what they find is this. So first of all, there's some rather trivial examples of second-order operators which preserve the Laplacian, because what you can do here, you can take any function at all, any smooth function at all, and take the differential operator, which is that smooth function, just multiplied on the left by the Laplacian itself. Now, this one clearly preserves harmonic functions because it kills them. Okay, so these are kind of boring ones, but these things here, which are proportional to the Laplacian, these should count as being second-order differential operators preserving the Laplacian, preserving harmonic functions. Okay, but what you find is that apart from these ones, and apart from the ones you've already got on the previous slide, an 11-dimensional family, you get another 35-dimensional family. This is in R3. They only do it in R3. So a 35-dimensional family of new ones. Actually, you have to look in their paper and make some small corrections to get this number. But 35 is the right number. Okay, now, how do these arise? Well, one way of getting second-order operators from first-order operators is to, well, compose them. But we've already, on the previous slide, we already looked at the commutator. That's the same thing with a minus sign. So in order to generate new ones, perhaps it would be good to look at the anti-commutator, so where you put a plus sign here. So certainly if D1 and D2 preserve harmonic functions, then so does this combination, and it gives you second order ones. Okay, so you're naturally drawn to looking at the 10-dimensional space that you already had, which we know now to identify with SO41 as a Lie algebra. You're naturally drawn to looking at that and looking at its symmetric tensor product, the symmetric tensor product of this with itself. This will be the natural home for these operators. And if you look at the dimension of this space, well, it was 10-dimensional, so it's 10 times 11 divided by 2, which is 55. So not 35, as one might expect. So where does the number 35 come from? Well, just experimentally, what you should do now is, well, maybe instead of looking at this this big vector space, suppose you should always, you know, as a representation theorist, you should always break it up into irreducibles. So let's do that. So here are some hieroglyphics which describe how this breaks up into irreducibles. Okay, so this is a notation, if you like, for just wedge 2 of R5. Right, so this is this 10-dimensional space, symmetric tensor product with the 10-dimensional space. And what I'm doing is breaking this up as representations of SO41. So it just decomposes into pieces. So some of these pieces we've seen before. This, for example, is the space of tensors with Weyl symmetry. This is the symmetric trace-free tensors. This is the real numbers. And this is tensors which are skew. So tensors on R5 which are skew. So a four-dimensional space at the end. A five-dimensional space. Tensors on R6. So these are the dimensions of these spaces. So 55, which is what we got on the left, is equal to, and then these are the dimensions of these spaces, and you spot that one of them has dimension 35. Aha! Right, so this 35 is the same as that 35. Okay, so the suspicion is that somehow these representations here, this space here, is controlling the additional second-order symmetries of the Laplacian. Right, that's the suspicion, and I want to convince you, of course, that this is... First thing to convince you of is that this is actually true. Right, I must say that so these people and various other people had as their motivation this business about separation of variables for, well, the Laplacian in this case. But Conrad was talking yesterday about this problem of separation of variables for various other differential operators. This is a classical subject. Goes back to Burke and Bateman and various other people since then, including, well, especially Kalnins and Miller following this up. And the motivation for them, and in this book, the book is called something like, what's it called? What's it called? Symmetry and Separation of Variables. That's the title of the book by Willard Miller. Thanks, Dennis. So this is their motivation. Okay, but so for them, there's no need to go to third order operators or anything like that. They're happy with this answer. Okay, but we would like to consider differential operators of higher and higher order. All right, so what about third order? Yeah. Yes.
But sort of skew symmetric with respect to the inner product that you're
using. No. So this is just my notation for SO41, which means identifying the standard representation with R5, and then this is just wedge 2 of R5 using the inner product to lower the index. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Right. So this is the adjoint representation of SO41. Right. Okay, third order. Okay, now we're going to put that question on the side for a moment and just look at some conformal geometry in order to help us answer the question about what are the third order ones, because the suspicion is that conformal geometry is helpful here. Okay, so just to recall some of the things from the first talk, so the way to think of Rn, which is what our question is about, right, the Laplacian on Rn, the way to think of it from a conformal point of view is by means of stereographic projection from the sphere, and the advantage is that then you get a genuine group of symmetries. So then you get not just the Lie algebra, but the actual group acting, SON plus 1, 1, and it's acting on the sphere by means of conformal transformations, and here's the picture of how it's acting. Right. By the way, all these transparencies are on my website for all of these talks.
Can we go back just a little? Well, we don't need to go back there. Why?
Yeah.
So when you take, are you just asserting that when you take this symmetrized
Yep.
That you end up projecting into to the first factor that you know.
Yes. Yeah, so at the moment this is just a guess that the first factor here is controlling these new symmetries. Right, so in other words, if you take projection into any of these other ones, that will already be absorbed into being of this form.
That's a different assertion.
No, it's not a different assertion.
No, but what I'm saying is, so it's not that the projections of the other factors are zero, it's just that you have them already on your list from the Laplacian.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, but those are equivalent.
They don't mind.
Okay. It's actually equivalent by counting dimensions at this stage. But anyway, never mind. Okay. Yeah, well, that's the whole point of the talk is to explain that. Yes. Okay, right. So hang on. right. Yes. This at the moment the previous slide was just sort of numerology, just setting the scene, setting the scene for an intelligent guess. But now we've got to do some mathematics, right? So okay. Right, so just to recall that the proper scene here is the sphere under the action of SOM plus 1, 1. This is the flat model of conformal geometry. Okay. Now, in terms of that flat model, the thing is that there's a really good way of describing the Laplacian. This is actually from Dirac in 1935. So I guess I put the precise citation on the... on the list of references for the first talk. So one of the people that realized, you know, how good the Laplacian was after the classical people like Bateman and so on, was Dirac in 1935. And he has the following argument, which I will now give you. This is Dirac's argument for how you both describe the Laplacian on the sphere and how you see that it is conformally invariant, all in one hit. Okay, so what he does is he introduces coordinates on, this is on Rm plus 2, right? So this is the coordinates on Rm plus 2, and this is the distance, the Lorentzian distance on Rm plus 2. This is the thing which is being preserved by SOM plus 1, 1. And the space R equals 0 is the null cone. The natural operator which is associated with this is this wave operator. So it's just it's like the Laplacian. I've written it as if it sort of looks like the Laplacian, but it's actually an indefinite signature version of the Laplacian. So it's a wave equation, so a wave operator. Okay, so this operator is invariant under the action of SOM plus 1, 1. Okay, so then, well, the zero set of F is the null cone, and you look at a function which is defined on the null cone. And if that function were homogeneous of degree zero, that would be a genuine homogeneous function on the sphere. A genuine function on the sphere, right? Because remember, the sphere is the space of null generators for the cone. So if you have a function homogeneous of degree W, that's sort of a little bit like a function on the sphere. Okay, and what you do is the following. So let's just do the following trick calculation and see what happens. I'll try and draw a picture of this. So just roughly speaking. Because this comes up a lot, so as Robin was saying, one of the disadvantages of having, I'll do it over there, one of the disadvantages of having transparent overhead projector, computer projection is that you tend to lose continuity. So let me just draw a picture of what I'm doing here. Okay, so we've got the null cone in R n plus 2. And what I'm doing is I'm imagining I have a function just defined on the boundary here with a homogeneity W in this null direction. And the first thing you do, what Dirac tells you to do, is you extend this to a function which is defined actually in all of, well, nearby in all of Rm plus 2. Again, but you maintain this homogeneity of homogeneous of degree W. So this is what I mean by ambiently extend. So you just extend this function off the null cone. The freedom in doing that is that, well, you've got this thing defined by r equals 0, and r is a function homogeneous of degree 2, as you can see. So the freedom is to extend it by, well, a multiple of r, but g should be homogeneous of degree w minus 2 in order for this to be homogeneous of degree w in total. So that's the freedom that you have in extending this function for an arbitrary g homogeneous of degree w minus 2. And then you apply the ambient Laplacian, or this wave operator, to this freedom. So this is the freedom that you have. You apply this wave operator, this is the thing which is invariant under SOM plus 1, 1, and you calculate, and you find that you get one term where the Laplacian, or the wave operator, just hits g, and then you get some constant multiple of g itself coming back. That's what happens. Okay? And you notice that that number there, n plus 2w minus 2, is a number which appeared in the second talk yesterday. Okay, so it's a magic number. And in particular, when w is equal to 1 minus n over 2, this number vanishes. Okay, this term is not there. So that if you look at the freedom and you restrict it, if you take this right-hand side and you restrict it to r equals 0, restrict it back to the null cone, then the right-hand side vanishes identically. So the freedom is simply not seen. Okay, so in this operation now, which starts with f, it takes an arbitrary extension, it applies this and restricts back to the null cone, you don't see the freedom at all. So this is invariantly defined. This is in Dirac's article. Right, and if you compute and find out what it is on Rn under identifying the sphere in the standard way and stereographic projection, you find that this operator is the Laplacian. And on the sphere, you find that this operator is this operator. It's the Yamabe operator from one of the lectures, from the second lecture yesterday, where this is the scalar curvature. In this case, this is on the sphere, so this is just a constant. Okay, so this is just some calculation in local coordinates. You can check that what's happening is this. But I mean, clearly, this entire construction from there to there is invariant under the action of SOM plus 1, 1. This is ages ago, 1935. Nowadays, this has a name. So constructions like this are called, well, this is an example of something, a very simple example of something called the ADS-CFT correspondence in physics, or in where there are various names for these various things, like ambiently extending, well, physicists would say be extending to the bulk, and so on. And in mathematics, this is an example of the, again, a very simple example of the Pfefferman-Graham ambient metric construction, which Robin Graham was describing yesterday, except he was describing a curved version of this. So this is the flat model on which this sort of thing is modeled. Okay? But anyway, this is a way of viewing the Laplacian in a completely invariant way, in a conformally invariant way. That's the idea. Okay, now. Right, so now let's bear that in mind in trying to investigate the symmetries of the Laplacian. Now, previously I defined a symmetry to be simply something which preserves harmonic functions, but here's a better definition. First of all, well, it looks different. This is how your symmetry, this differential operator, should interact with the Laplacian. It should be that when you apply the symmetry and follow it by the Laplacian, what you get is a different differential operator, perhaps, times the Laplacian itself, composed in the other order. Right? So it's almost like they're commuting, but actually delta need not be the same as d. Now, clearly, if you have such an operator, it preserves harmonic functions. Right, because you apply this to a function f, and if it's harmonic, the right-hand side vanishes, so does the left-hand side. But conversely, in fact, this is equivalent on Rn, but that's simply because there are many, many harmonic functions on Rn. This is something which is checked by in Willard Miller's book. Okay, but this is a better definition because, for example, this applies on the sphere. Whereas preserving harmonic functions on the sphere is a trivial question because harmonic functions are constants on the sphere. So this is my new definition of symmetry, or new definition of the problem. So what I'm trying to find is symmetries. Okay, so now let's just extend this sort of trivial business that we had before. If you have a differential operator which is any differential operator you like called P, composed on the left with the Laplacian, this is certainly a symmetry. You put it into here and you just group the differential operators in a different way to say what delta should be. So this is a trivial example of a symmetry. And so it might be a good idea to get rid of this nonsense right away and define two symmetries to be equivalent. So this is now an equivalence relation among symmetries by saying they're equivalent if their difference is trivial in this manner. Right, so that will get rid of the ambiguity that was on this earlier slide for second order operators. So that's what I'm doing in a more general context. Okay, in which case Rn gives rise to the algebra of symmetries. Now it really is an algebra in the sense that what is this algebra? Well, it's this algebra of symmetries by definition is that it's the symmetries, these are differential operators which have this property, considered up to this equivalence, and the algebra structure is simply composition. Right? So not Lie algebra, not taking the commutator or anything, but just simply composition. So this gives you an algebra of symmetries. And the question is, what is this algebra? Okay, so not only what are the higher order symmetries, but how do they compose? Right? That's a separate question. Okay, so now I'm going to try and answer this question. Right, so this is a more detailed question of even just what are the higher order symmetries. Now, in order to answer this question, what you can do is simply just plug a general differential operator into this equality here and see what happens. Right, so what you do is you write out, this is just on flat space, these are just the flat derivative here. What you do is write this out as a leading order part and lower order terms. So this is may as well taken to be a symmetric tensor. So this will be the symbol of this differential operator. And the first thing you can do is, by means of this equivalence, you may as well take this thing to be trace-free. See, the point is that if there are any traces in here, this will give rise to Laplacians here. This is true even in the curved setting. Right, so even if I'm trying to look at this on a general manifold, you can remove the traces here by dint of this equivalence, by just throwing away the trivial symmetries, and you can take this symbol to be not only symmetric but also trace-free. So the symbol of this is a trace-free symmetric tensor. Okay, and then here are the theorems. So first of all, if you've got a symmetry, then in fact, if you just plug it into that definition, then you find that the symbol is constrained, and it's constrained in this way. It's constrained in that the trace-free part, the trace-free part of this symmetric product should be equal to zero. So it satisfies what is rather a strong differential equation. Right, that's the first thing. That's quite easy. Right, that's just a matter of plugging it into the definition. The second thing is that on Rn, there's a converse. On Rn, if you've got some such a thing, I'm going to give it a name. This is a conformal killing tensor, one of these things. This thing here gives rise to a symmetry. Right, so this, as I said, is easy. This is not so easy. And for this, you really do need this ambient construction in order to give a nice clean proof of this. Okay, so that's not so easy. Let me just say a bit more about what this actually means. Okay, so what this means is that any time you have one of these things, a solution of this differential equation, then what you get is a canonically associated symmetry which has this as its symbol, and then it has some lower order terms. So the lower order terms are canonically determined by V. Okay, so this is all supposed to be controlled by this one gadget called V, a conformal killing tensor. Now, if you look at the formulae for these things in Rn, they get quite complicated. The first order ones are not too bad. So this is a first. This is exactly what you have to add for the lower order terms, right, in order to make this thing into a symmetry. So here, V is a conformal killing vector. Right, so it's a conformal symmetry. And this is how this thing should act just on functions here. So it is important here that F have exactly this weight, 1 minus n over 2. That's where this it drastically affects what the coefficient is that you have to put here. These are the first order ones. The second order ones, okay, some explicit formulae. These formulae rapidly get out of control, but you can write them all down explicitly. So there's some particular, very, very particular constants that you've got to put against the evident choice of lower order terms that you can put in here. Okay, so this is what happens. Okay, now, I'll just tell you the ingredients of the proof, because what you don't do is compute in Rn. You certainly don't do that. You use this Dirac trick. You use this this correspondence. Okay, this is what you do. First thing is you can actually solve this equation. You can solve the conformal killing tensor equation. This is what it is written out more explicitly. It's to say that the symmetric part is pure trace. You can solve this equation on Rn explicitly. This is what Konrad Schoebel was doing yesterday in the context of just killing tensors, not conformal killing tensors. Okay, and you can do this either by prolongation or by something I was talking about yesterday, this BGG machinery, and what you get is really nice. It's an irreducible representation of this Lie algebra. So this is just a generalization of what happened for second order tensors, where what we got here was some 35 dimensional space in R3. This is the general result in Rn and for differential operators of any order. The order, the number of boxes or the number of columns here that you have to put is just the number of indices. So if you're looking for kth order symmetries, then you should have k columns here, so 2k boxes in all. These are the Cartan powers of the adjoint representation. Yep. Right, and just to say what happens when there's just one index, these are conformal killing vectors, then this is translation, rotation, dilation, and inversion. The one-dimensional case, I mean, when there's just one index, sorry, the first-order case, there are nice geometric interpretations of what a conformal killing vector is. But unfortunately, one of the issues here is that is to think of a good reason why all this works. And I don't know a useful interpretation in this context of what a conformal killing tensor is. So there are some. yes. It's not as simple as that. Yes, and it's neither as simple as, other interpretations that one might have, like.
But that's another. That's where this algebra shows up.
Yes. No, not where this algebra shows up. Where a different algebra shows up. Yes, you'll see. Yeah. Okay. Right. So, the ingredients of the proof are twofold. You can solve the conformal killing equation, right? And then the point is that this thing here, this gadget here, is something which involves tensors in Rm plus 2, right? So even in this case, it's tensors in Rm plus 2. So it's sort of dragging you towards using ambient methods, okay? By what ambient methods means that you just write something down in terms of, yeah, match it. Yes. Yeah. Okay, that was something else I was trying to suppress. When I said I didn't know it, yeah. So when I said I don't know any useful, right? So yes, I know that, of course, right? But as it turns out, right, I cannot find how to use that in this context, right? It is true that there's a geometric interpretation of these things as constants of constants along non-geodesics. Okay, that will constants of the motion for certain differential operators, but that doesn't appear to be helpful in this context. It might be, but not to me. Okay, right. So as a corollary, if you just want to know what all of these higher order symmetries are as a vector space, then it looks like this. Right, so this is just a trivial direct sum. Right, but it doesn't answer the question of what this is as an algebra. This is going to come to answering JM's point in a moment. Right, so as a vector space, it looks like this. And you might think you're done because this looks like the coordinate ring and so on. But you haven't answered the question of what is the algebra structure. Right, so what is the algebra structure? What about the algebra structure? Right, so as a vector space, it's canonically this. But that's not really what you want. So if you let's just compare this with, suppose you were given a Lie algebra, right? So as a Lie algebra, the natural algebra that you have associated with a Lie algebra is the universal enveloping algebra. And as a vector space, right, it's simply this. It's simply canonically that, right? But it doesn't tell you what the algebra structure is. The algebra structure is, to say it's opaque here, is a vast understatement. Right? This does not tell you anything at all about the algebra structure. It tells you what it is, a vector space. So this question remains as what is the algebra structure on AN? All right, so let me just tell you what the algebra structure is, and first of all compare it with how you would write the algebra structure for the universal enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra. So this is the definition of the universal enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra. This is sort of our model. Okay, and let me just rewrite that in a way which is a bit more suggestive. I'm going to take that generator there in that ideal, that two-sided ideal, and divide it by two, and rewrite the first thing as just the tensor product of x and y minus, and then this is the symmetric tensor product. So that's 1/2 of x tensor y minus y tensor x. Okay, so you rewrite it like that. And then, bearing that in mind, this is what the answer is for the algebra structure on this algebra AN. Right, so it's got various ingredients which you recognize as having something to do with the corresponding formula for the universal enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra. So first of all, it's actually got exactly these two ingredients, this and this, which is exactly like the universal enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra. But then it's got these two extra ingredients. So this thing here is just the Lie bracket. This thing here is the killing form. That's what that is. Right, so notice that it's taking things here in degree 2. This is quadratic, and it's generating something in a low. This is not a homogeneous ideal. It's not even it's not homogeneous here, but it's actually getting some zeroth order pieces in from there as well. And then it's got this piece as well. This is the Cartan product. So whenever you have two elements of a representation of some simple Lie algebra, you can take the part which lies in the highest weight component of the tensor product. That has a name. It's called the Cartan product. Okay, so these are... This is a really good algebra because it involves, the three classical guys, right? So it's really, really, really cool. Yes. The associated graded. The associated graded is the coordinate ring, right? But you miss all of the structure by doing this. Yeah. Right. Equivalently, this already has another name. If you do this, if you take just this part of the generator and already remove that, then you get down to the universal enveloping algebra of this algebra. And then what you're doing is you're factoring by a particular ideal which has a nice classical name. This is the universal enveloping algebra modulo the so-called Joseph ideal. The proof of the algebra structure is just to check. So it's almost impossible to do this directly I can't do it actually. So on the level of actual differential operators. But what you can do is check it for first order differential operators and check that this relationship holds. This is the relationship you're going to divide out by in this algebra. And then you use some properties of Cartan products. So you use some representation theory, actually due to constant. Okay, I just remark that this number, let me just go back a little bit. Yeah, this number here looks like a very weird number. You know, where does this come from? You might think you could put any number in there and get some interesting algebra, but you can't. Okay, so if you've got a simple Lie algebra and you do this for any of the simple Lie algebras apart from the trivial example of SL2C, and you put any constant you like here, generally speaking, you get either the zero-dimensional or one-dimensional result. And you only get an infinite-dimensional algebra here, an interesting algebra specifically for one value of lambda. Okay, the corresponding graded Lie algebra looks like that for this case. Okay, what about curved analogs? As soon as you've found these nice, what's going on Rn, one should now ask about curved analogs. And for vector fields, there's no problem. This thing here, exactly the same formula that you have in flat space works in curved space. And because there's a geometric interpretation of this, then you can easily see that this thing here is a symmetry of the Laplacian in curved space, provided V is a conformal vector field, conformal killing field. And sure enough, in a curved space, you can add curvature correction terms so that for any trace-free symmetric tensor field, so this thing is fixed here, then this operator here is conformally invariant, but you have to put in these extra curvature terms. So precisely this quantity here. So you have to add curvature correction terms in order to make it conformally invariant. So, you know, just as there are many differential operators in flat space which have curved versions, so do these potential symmetries. But I do not know, so I mean, and the higher ones as well. I mean, it's not just second order ones, all of them do. Right? But I don't know whether these provide curved symmetries. So in other words, if you've got a conformal killing vector, then the geometric interpretation of conformal killing vector is that this is a symmetry of the conformal Laplacian. But for conformal killing tensor, even if it's only got two indices, right, this is in principle just a calculation. Yeah, just a calculation. Ho, ho, ho. Yeah, so even in three dimensions, right? So I do not know whether if you've got a conformal killing tensor, whether it provides a symmetry of the conformal Laplacian. This is what you might expect. So I think this is still unknown. Is it still unknown, Alfredo? Yeah. Still unknown. Okay, still unknown in general. Right, okay. So Alfredo's PhD thesis was using this to using Mathematica to try and answer this question by just using a computer, in particular Mathematica, to try and answer this question. Okay, right. It's a very complicated question. Seems so simple, but it's unknown. Okay, so you can do your various variations on this theme. So I'll just mention some of them, and then that's it. So another operator you should try this for is the Dirac operator. So for example, in even dimensions, you should look at the Dirac operator and ask about symmetries. The definition is exactly the same. It's not just a scalar operator anymore. So you've got to have your symmetries here, D and delta. You notice a slight difference here between the Dirac operator and this thing here, which is a symmetry, that's calligraphic D. So this operator, but the definition is essentially the same. This is what a symmetry should be. And again, you can check that if you have a symmetry, then the symbol should satisfy some conformally invariant overdetermined system of partial differential equations, which means it's actually gives you an irreducible representation. It's not irreducible. Anyway, it gives you some finite dimensional vector space of potential symmetries. And the first order symmetries were sorted out even in curved space by Ben and Kress, and the higher order symmetries in the flat space were sorted out, but we haven't written it up yet, I'm afraid, by myself and Peter Sonberg and Vladimir Sauchek. Okay, and you could try another operator, the square of the Laplacian. That's conformally invariant. So you can run through that. You get the symmetry algebra then has some extra ingredients. So things start changing, like For the Joseph, I mean, so this should be a sort of some sort of higher version of the Joseph ideal, whatever that means. Okay, and you notice that this constant is vastly different here, and there's an extra ingredient here, which is some other part of the tensor product here you have to take into account, and there's some fourth order generators as well. So quite a few, so a different number and a couple of different ingredients, and the graded part counterpart here doesn't just have these parts in it, but it also has some extra bits. When n equals 4, I mean, when n equals 4, you can see there's nothing special about n equals 4 in flat space. It's this constant happens to be 0, but yeah. This holds for n greater or equal to 3. There's nothing special about n equals 4 from this point of view. Okay. So although, I mean, one might suspect that, but no. Okay, it's no different. Okay, that's the end of it. Thank you very much. It's projecting onto one of the other components in the tensor product. It doesn't have a well-known name. No. Yeah, I think it's projecting onto into a sort of hook thing. So, just. if you look at this. Full tensor product this, then the bits that we had before, which were this bit, and then there's some extra bits, which are, so these are this from the symmetric, and then from the skew bit, there's this bit and one of these. So, actually, I can't remember what dot is, but I think it's projection into this bit. But it's in the article which I cited at the beginning. I can't actually remember, but it's projection into one of the other bits. But it doesn't have a nice name.
For other powers of Laplacian.
Yeah, for other powers of the Laplacian. There's a preprint, isn't there, by Joseph Shilhan and Rod Gover? Is that right? Yeah. So there's a preprint lying around by Rod Gover and Joseph Shilhan that generalise this to higher powers. And you have to put in more things here. So this bit, and some more, and so on. No. I mean the it just gets more and more complicated in a sort of controlled way. There's nothing exotic happens. No, it doesn't stabilize. At low order. I mean, one of the things that's different is, of course, if you're looking at high powers of the Laplacian, then you don't see any of this equivalence until you get up to differential operators which have order greater than the high power that you've chosen, greater than the order that you've chosen. So there's no ideal that you're factoring out by. So I think the lower order bits might even look the same. But then the higher order bits start collapsing, but in a very controlled way. Yeah.
Sorry, my probably some question, but all the higher order symmetries are still in the developing of the.
Oh yes. 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 So in all.
The first order one.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
But for maximal equation, which is also a component, I don't
yes.
think that's
that are not generated by the.
Yes.
Oh, I'd be shocked by that. But anyway, yeah, you might be right, but. Okay. Maybe, yes, okay.
Yeah, there's a reason, yeah.
Okay, all right, we'll have to talk about that afterwards, yep. Yeah. Yes.
Dilation.
Yes.
And you said there was some special significance.
Yes. Okay. Right. Let me just go back a few slides, and I can. Okay, use the buttons to go back. It's quicker, isn't it? Yeah, here we go. Right, yes, so right, so it depends on the weight of the operator as to how V naturally acts as a vector field. So it has to, you have to take into account W. And the general formula is that if you have a W, if you have a function, right, then and you have a vector field, of course the action of the vector field on the function is just to do that. But if you have a function of weight W, the way that it acts is you have to plus W over N times this bit here, times the divergence of V times F. Okay? And W, when W is equal to 1 minus N over 2, that explains where this thing comes from. Okay? And if you put N equal to 3 here, then you get... No, n equal to 3, what's going on? Oh, wait, n equal to 3. That 1 half is actually equal to minus 1 minus n over 2 when n equals 3. Yeah, I was getting ahead of myself a little bit there, but that 1 half... Yeah, it's to do with this, but it's not exactly this. It's to do with the fact that your vector field is not acting just on a function, but it's acting on a weighted function. Right. So, oh yes, if you do this with where this is, if you do this formula where this is the Euler field, right, this is the Euler field, so XA, then this thing here will be N, which will cancel with that N, and then you'll get plus W. But W in this particular case is 1 minus N over 2. So if you just had an ordinary function, this is how vector fields act on functions. But if you have a weighted function, this is what you've got to do in order to compensate for it. And when you plug it in, when you use the Euler field, then this number will be 1 half or minus 1 half. Yeah. Right, so that's where the half comes from. Okay. Yep.
So you said you have to get all these formulas in higher order, you have to go to the ambient.
No, you don't. No. Okay. Right. No. The order of events is like this. If you want to prove that all of these operators exist and so on and interact with the Laplacian in the best way, in the right way, then you should prove that by ambient means.
Where the conformal just becomes like killing instead of killing vectors, killing
tensors. Yes. Yes. Yes, they be, yes.
Take the thing upstairs and drop them down.
Yes, right. But that gives you a proof of existence, right? Now, if you want the formulae, right, then you should not. Then there's some tricks, and what you do is you know the existence, and then even just the conformal invariance of the formulae actually just fixes these lower order terms. Right, so these, in order to get these formulae, you play the moves in the following order. You know that these things exist and are symmetries and are conformally invariant by ambient construction, and then you just use the conformal invariance to say this is what they should be. The symbol then fixes all of these lower order terms, and then you can determine what they have to be just by pure thought without knowing anything about the proof. Right. Yeah.
So, do you know that operator has, if there is an...
That's right.
That one
has to be the right one. Well, that's the only conformally invariant addition
that...
Okay. Okay. So it depends... So it depends on the definitions. Right. So, of course, it is, of course, this theorem is actually just true in general because, generally speaking, there are no conformal killing tensors at all. Right. So there's definitely no restriction on this as In any particular example, you can take any yeah, right. Question of existence, right. So the formula, well, the only possible justification could be that this is the right formula in certain cases. And we know it's the right formula in the flat case. And so it's sort of slightly murky waters, but you could probably say some precise statement where this has to be the right answer. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yes. I don't know. you'd expect it should, but I don't know. Sorry.